Lord-Arcanums are sorcerers capable of wielding the cerulean energies of Azure, and mounted atop a Gryph-Charger, they make a dramatic centerpiece to your army and a powerful general as well. In this video, we're going to show you how to paint one in the colours of the Hammers of Sigmar, and we're going to show you how to paint it so it can be on the tabletop and ready for battle in no time, but also how to add additional highlights to make the model truly something special. So, without further ado, let's get started. As with any Citadel miniature, the first thing you should do with this model is undercoat it. And for this example, we've gone for Mechanicus Standard Grey. This undercoat colour is perfect for this model because it's a great mid-tone for lots of the colours we're going to be using, especially on the Gryph-Charger. And in fact, that's where we're going to begin. The first colour we need is Cobalt Green. And as always, be sure to give all your paints a really good shake before you use each one. I'm going to be applying this using a large base brush, but you could go for a medium base brush if you prefer. But whatever the case, what you should do is just use your brush to get a little bit of this paint and then put it onto your palette like this. Now, once you've done so, add a small amount of water to the mix. You don't need loads, but doing so just thins that paint down and makes it smoother. And what's going to happen now is it'll go further, it'll dry smoother, and it won't clog up detail either. So get some loaded up on your brush, and once you've done so, all you've got to do is start applying it to the smoother parts of the Gryph-Charger's body. So the areas we're looking at are such as the forearm just down here, like this, and there's a little bit of his back showing just up there, so we need to get that part there as well. So all the time we're looking for these parts of the body that's smoother, but avoiding the textured parts such as the feathers around here, or the scales down there, and we've got the fur down there as well. So once you've got all these parts, just apply a second thin coat in exactly the same way, just to ensure the colour's nice and solid before you move on to the next step. Once you've finished with Cobalt Green, you're then ready to move on to the next colour, and this is going to be Araman Blue. Now this is for all the feathers on the Gryph-Charger, and because we need a bit more control now, I'm going to be applying this using a medium base brush. As before though, use the palette to get the paint ready by putting a little bit on there like that, and then adding a small amount of water to the mix so it's nice and smooth. And once you've done so, as I said, it's just a matter of picking out the feathers. Now when you're doing this, just bear in mind some of the feathers touch onto the Cobalt Green, so when you get to parts like that, such as just here, start painting in a roughly stabbing motion like this to create a rough line between the two colours, and that'll give more of a natural blend between the two areas like that. So for this part, you're looking at painting all the feathers around here, all the way up on top of the head, but also you need to paint these feathers on the back of the foreclaws as well. And with that done, we're now ready to move on to the third colour for the Gryph-Charger's flesh, and this is going to be Incubi Darkness. Now, once again, I'm going to apply it with a medium base brush, and what we're looking to pick out here this time is the fur, and also the scales and the claws and the forelimbs. Once your paint is ready, as before, and thinned down, all you've got to do then is start painting over these areas. And we're going to start with these claws around here. So we're looking at the harder parts of scales around here, like this. As before, painting kind of rough when you meet the Cobalt Green, so you get a natural blend between the two colours. There like that, and then just base coating all the rest of them. But also we want to paint in the fur back here, so you just want to paint in areas such as just along here, again getting a bit rough as you get close to the Cobalt Green. Now that those three colours are established on the Gryph-Charger's body, we're ready to shade them. And for this, what we'll need is Collier Green Shade, and what this is going to do is give the colour some depth and also tie them together. I'm going to be applying this using a medium shade brush, and for this kind of paint, you still want to use a palette, even though you don't need to add any water to the mix. So just straight out the pot is perfectly fine. But having the palette here means you can control exactly how much you're applying at once, and you don't want to overdo it, you see, so the palette helps avoid that problem. So load your brush up, and when you're ready, all you've got to do is paint this colour over the three you've done so far. So for example, on the limb here, I'm going to paint it on all three, and you can see it runs into the recesses and gives some really nice shading whilst also tying the colours together. Give the shade about half an hour to completely dry, and once that's done, you're then ready to move on to the next step, which is to start painting in the beak. Now for this, we're going to begin with a base coat of Avalan Sunset, and whilst we're at it, we're also going to base coat the eyes. But after that, we'll move on to Reichland Flesh Shade to shade it. So first of all then, we need Avalan Sunset, and there's going to be two steps to painting this in. First of all, for the beak, we need a medium base brush, and as always, you want to use your palette here to get the paint ready, adding a small amount of that water into the mix just there like that, so it's nice and thin and smooth. That's a little bit more, I think. There we go, down to about that there. And once you've done so, all you've got to do is start applying this to the beak. Now as you do this, just be as neat as you can, just having lots of control of your brush as you get close to that flesh you've painted already. See, I'm just being really steady as I paint along that part there, and it can be much quicker as you paint the rest of it. And with this, you will need to apply two thin coats, just be sure the first coat is completely dry before you do the second. Now as for the eye, what we need this time is a much smaller brush. I'm going to go for a small layer brush, and as you get the paint onto this, a good thing to do is just to twist the bristles of the brush. So I'll just get that ready there. There we go, just twist the bristles as you drag it along to bring them to a nice tip so you've got lots of control over them. And once you've done so, all you've got to do is brace your hands and hold them as steady as possible as you just apply this colour just to the middle of the eye like that, just leaving it darker around the outside. And once the base coat's dry, you're then ready to shade over the beak only, this time using Reichlin Flesh Shade, applied with a medium shade brush. And once that shade is dry, we're then ready to move on to the next area of detail in the Gryph-Charger before we move on to the Lord Arcanum himself. Now, this is going to be all the harder parts of the body. So there's a few here. We've got the horns. We've also got some scales in the forelimbs and the hooves as well. And for this, we're going to start out with a base coat of dried bark, then we'll shade over them with Norn oil. Now, first of all, we're going to base coat with dried bark, and I'm going to be doing this using the medium base brush again. And as before, use the palette to get your paint ready. And also be careful here to make sure that your brush isn't overloaded, because these details now are quite small, so we do need a lot of control here. So I'm going to begin with the forelimbs just here. The kind of parts we're looking to paint here are these ridges we've got along the back. So you just want to base coat along these like this, and getting the smaller ones just on these little parts down here too. Now I need to paint the hooves as well down here, so be sure to base coat all of these just around there. And of course we need to paint in the horns as well. Now as you're doing the horns, just be careful and just angle the model so you can get the brush in like that so as not to get the paint onto the feathers. And then shade over all the dried bark using Norn oil. Now this time you don't want to apply too much at once, so I recommend using a medium layer brush to help control it. And also whilst you're doing this step, it's a good idea just to run some of this shade into the recess of the eye as well, just to blackline the outline of it. And with those darker areas of the Gryph-Charger now shaded, we're ready to move on to what is surely the biggest feature of the Hammers of Sigmar, and that is their gold armour. Now to base coat this, we need Retributor armour, and I'm going to be applying it mostly using the medium base brush again, but it's a good idea to have a small layer brush on hand because you will need it for all the finer details. It'll give you much more control around those parts. But first of all, get the paint ready and thin down on your palette, and once you've done so, it's just a matter of base coating all the gold details, and there are quite a few of these. And as you do this, you don't have to worry about being too neat, because we will neaten up other colours as we continue. But the only area to be careful around is on the Gryph-Charger whenever you get close to its flesh. For example, the armour just round here, you can see it's going to be really neat as I paint along there. And with this colour, you will need to apply two thin coats. With that gold armour base coated, we're now ready to shade it. And this time we're going to use Reichlin Flesh Shade Gloss. And this is to give a nice warmth to that gold armour, but also to make it nice and shiny as well. I'm going to be applying it mostly using the medium shade brush again, but have the medium layer brush on hand, because like with base coating the gold, it's a good idea to have a smaller brush just for a little bit more control where you need it, especially where the armour meets the flesh of the Gryph-Charger. But like with all shade, just use your palette to help gauge how much you have on your brush. And once you've done so, all you've got to do is start painting this over your armour. And you'll see straight away it runs into all that recess detail and really gives it depth, but also gives it a lovely shine as well. Once you apply this all over the gold, give it around about half an hour to dry before you move on to the next step. The Reichlin Flesh Shade Gloss is now completely dry, and you can see what a wonderful shine it's given to all of that gold armour. And with that done, we're now ready to move on to the next phase, which is to carry on applying all the remaining base colours to the model. Now the first one that we need is Cantor Blue for all the blue details, and this is mostly fabric and robes and things, but also there's a little bit on the armour as well. Now to apply this, I'm going to be using a medium layer brush and a small layer brush, and I recommend you do the same and just switch between the two of them as and when you need to, whatever you feel more comfortable with really. Whatever the case, you need a lot of control here now, because we need to paint this in amongst all that gold that we've done. So again, use your palette to get the paint ready and just twist the bristles like this on your brush just to bring them together to a nice point so you've got lots of control about where you want to apply it. And for the fabric, what you want to do now is just carefully start painting this on like this, just being really neat and avoiding those other colours we've done so far. So you can see around this gold design we've got here, it's being just really neat, and just taking my time working around it like that so as not to go over any of the gold. Now there is quite a few blue details to paint in here, so if you're not sure which bits to do, then just check out the box art and that'll guide you through which parts to paint in. Once you've finished picking out all those details with Cantor Blue, you're ready for the next base colour, which is Mephiston Red. Now this is going to be for the saddle cloth, but also we've got some gems to pick out and the helmet plume as well. Now once again, I'm going to be using both the medium layer and the small layer brush, and I'm going to start with the medium layer. And once the paint is ready, we just need to start picking these details out. But a lot of them are very finely detailed now, so remember, use your palette to get the paint under control and to get a fine tip on your brush. So for the gems, the areas we're looking at are ones such as this one just here. When you paint these in, just be careful to leave some gold around the outside, just for the edging of it there like that, just to trim around the outside of it. Now for the helmet plume, again, just be careful as you're painting around here, just because of all the gold details we've got. And the same is true with the saddle cloth as well. You can see how it goes underneath the foot of our Stormcast there. So just be careful around there, and again, around the feathers of the Gryph-Charger. Now that we've added Mephiston Red, the model's really starting to come together. In fact, we're now ready to move on to the next few base colours, and all of these are applied following the same techniques as what we've been doing so far, so we're going to run through them quickly for you now. First of all, we need a Baden Black, and this will be for all the joints in the Stormcast's armour and the leather straps as well. And after that, we need Celestra Grey for all the white details, such as the inside of the robes and some of the lightning sigils too. After that, we need Screamer Pink for the weapon grips, and this will be followed by Lead Belcher for all the silver details. Then we're going to move on to Rakarth Flesh for the tabard and also any parchment. And finally, we need Dryad Bark for the remaining leather, such as the leather gauntlets. But first of all, we need a Baden Black, and I'm going to start out with my medium layer brush here, but again, have that small layer brush on hand just in case you need it. And for this, we're looking for all the joints in the armour and the leather straps as well. So once your paint is thinned down and ready, it's just a matter of looking for these details. And some of them are quite small, and they can be a little bit tricky to get to, so just switch brushes as you need to. But you can see we've got the joint just down here, so I'm just going to be really careful as I paint this in around that gold armour there like that. With that done, we're then ready to apply some Celestra Grey. Now, this is for the inside of the robes on areas that we want to be white later on, so just along here. But also, we want to look out for any lightning bolt sigils as well and to pick those out. For example, we've got the ones on the front of the armour just here, so I'm just going to neatly paint these in like this. Next, we're ready to add some Screamer Pink, and this is for all the grips of the weapons. So we've got the staff just along here, but also we've got the sword hilt at his back just along here. With that done, we're now ready to start painting all the silver detail using Lead Belcher. Now when you're painting the scales here, just be careful to keep lots of control over your brush as you start painting around this gold design just here. Just really take your time working into the detail. But also don't forget to get the silver detail on the staff as well. And then we're ready to apply some Rakarth Flesh. Now this is for the tabard, which we've got just along here. And again, be really careful around this gold design we've got just there. But we also need to paint in all the parchments, such as the parchment we've got here on the staff. And the other detail to paint at this stage is the claws on the Gryph-Charger. And finally, base coat the leather of the gauntlets using Dryad Bark. With all those base colours now applied, we're ready to move on to the next step, which is to shade them all. Now, we're going to be using two different shades for this. First of all, we need normal oil for most of them, but then we're going to use Agrax Earthshade as well, and this is for all the parchment and the tabard. So essentially, anything we painted with Rakarth Flesh. So first of all, we need Norn Oil, and I'm going to be applying this using the medium layer brush, but it's a good idea to have a medium shade brush in hand too for larger areas. But to begin with, we need quite a bit of control here, as you'll see in a moment. So use the palette to make sure your brush isn't overloaded, and that you've got a good tip on it. And what you need to do is start running the shade in around all the colours that we've done so far, just catching those base colours we've added. So for example, if we look at these scales on here, what I'm going to do is just be really careful as I paint this in around that gem design just there like that, just keeping it under control and making sure not to overdo it. But for this colour, what you need to do is apply it over the silver areas, the blue areas, the Celestra Grey parts, such as just along here, and all the red parts as well. And don't forget as well to catch all the Screamer Pink parts too. And once the Norn Oil is completely dry, you're then ready to move on to Agrax Earthshade to shade over all the Rakarth Flesh details. So this will be the tabard along here, then we've got the parchment up here on the staff, and of course we need to shade this over the claws as well. The Agrax Earthshade is now completely dry too, and you can see it's given all that detail lots of depth and it's looking great. But it has darkened these colours down quite a bit, so what we're going to do now is just reapply some of those base colours, but with a technique this time called layering, where what we're going to do is brighten the back up again, but retain that depth that the shade's given us. So first of all, we're going to reapply Celestra Grey, and this time we're going to just use the medium layer brush. And to do this, what you should do is again use your palette to get the paint ready, because you do want a lot of control here, because there are specific parts we're looking to avoid on these colours. So get that paint thinned out and make sure your brush isn't overloaded. And what we're looking to do here is to avoid the areas where more of the shade settled on these parts. So if we look at this turn back we've got here on the barding, what I'm going to do is reapply Celestra Grey to where we had it before, like this, just following the length of that fabric all the way down. But you can see how we've got a recess there where we've got a bit of shade settled. What I'm going to do is just avoid that part and paint again on the other side. So this way you can see that I'm making the colour brighter again, but I'm retaining that depth just there of the shade settling in that part like that. So what you need to do now is carry on doing this on all the Celestra Grey details. Now I've finished reapplying Celestra Grey using that layering technique. You can see just what a difference it's made to the fabric. It's made it much brighter and cleaner and neater as well. And what we need to do now is carry on doing this to some other base colours. The next one's going to be Rakarth Flesh, and I'm going to be once again applying this using the medium layer brush. And the technique is just the same as what we've just been doing. So again, use your palette to get the paint ready, making sure it's nice and smooth, a little bit thinner than we had when we were base coating. But then importantly, just making sure that your brush isn't overloaded so that you've got lots of control over it. And then all you need to do is start reapplying this to all the Rakarth flesh details. So if I start with the tabard we've got just here, I'm going to be painting onto most of it, but again, looking for those recesses and avoiding them. So we've got one just there, so I'm just going to avoid that and start painting on the other side there like that. Now on the parchment, when you apply it to this area, what you should do is just avoid the recessed text. So just paint on the flatter areas like this, keeping that definition of the text there like that. And as for the claws, the best thing to do here is to paint in lines going along the length of them. So if I go for this one here, what I'm going to do is just paint lines like this, just running all the way down to the tip of the claw like that. And this way I'll really build up the texture of the claws. And with that done, we can now move on to reapplying the next base colour. And in fact, all the remaining base colours are applied from the exact same technique as what we've just been doing, so we're going to run through them quickly for you now. First of all, we need Cantor Blue to reapply to the blue parts, followed by Mephiston Red, and then we're going to be applying Lead Belcher as well. But first of all, we need Cantor Blue, and again, I'm going to be using my medium layer brush, but with this, you might want to have a medium base brush on hand, because some of the blue areas are quite large, especially on the back of the cloak, but it's entirely up to you whether you feel comfortable with that or not. Whatever the case though, again, use your palette to make sure your brush isn't overloaded and the paint is nice and smooth. And then all you've got to do is start applying to the blue areas, just looking for those recesses where the shade has settled. So on the cloak here, see it's nice and clear. What I'm going to do is just paint down that part just there, avoid that recess there, and then carry on painting on the other side. And you just repeat this technique across all the blue detail. Next, we're going to return to Mephiston Red, and this is going to be for the saddle cloth only. Don't worry about the gems or the helmet plume, because we will be coming back to those later. And finally, we're going back to Lead Belcher to brighten up all the silver details. And on the scales like this, all you need to do is paint towards the bottom of each one, just leaving them darker towards the top where they go underneath the one above. And with those colours reapplied, the model's looking fantastic. And in fact, you could leave it here if you wanted to and get it onto the battlefield straight away. But if you want to take your model to the next level, what we're going to do now is start adding some further details to it. And if you want to do this, what first of all you'll need is Collier Green Shade. Now we're going to be going back to the Gryph-Charger for this and adding more detail to that. And this time we need to apply this paint using a medium layer brush because we don't want loads of it now. In fact, we're going to be applying two coats of this in the same way. And to set it up, what you should do is use your palette to make sure that your brush isn't overloaded with this paint. And what you're looking to do is to apply this in any area where the green flesh transitions into another colour on its body. So for example, if we look at the side of the neck just along here, you can see we've got the blue and the green. What I'm going to do is start to hide this join between the two colours by applying the shade just over this part here like that. So fairly thickly over that area. And then, whilst the paint's still wet, I'm going to quickly dry my brush off on some tissue and then just start drawing that paint out onto the surrounding area of flesh. So what I do here is retain a strong colour down the middle, but I blend it out into the area around it, getting a nice smooth transition. So what we're going to do now is do this on all the areas where the colours join. So we've got here, on the limbs just here where the feathers meet them, and on the tails as well, we've got this part where the fur meets on the back. And we're going to be applying both these coats in exactly the same way. Once the first coat of Collier Green Shade is completely dry, apply a second coat of Collier Green Shade following the exact same technique and apply it in the exact same way. The shade is now completely dry and we're ready to begin adding some highlights to the Gryph-Charger. Now the first thing we're going to do here is dry brush with a colour called Skink Blue. And to dry brush, what you need is a small dry brush brush like one of these. And what you do is just get a small amount of this paint on the tip of the bristles and then get hold of some tissue. And what you do is use the tissue to work the paint in amongst the bristles like this, also getting rid of the excess paint off the brush. So the idea here is that when you start drawing across texture, it starts catching the edges of the texture and gives you a really nice highlight. So the areas we're looking to do this on are the feathers, and the feathers around the head as well, and also the fur down the tail, so the bluish kind of areas really. And what you do is just start drawing the brush like this, and you can see the colour just starting to catch those edges and giving us a really nice highlight really quickly and easily. So what you need to do is just bring the colour slightly onto the transition onto the green, so down to about there, and just slowly take your time working around. Now it is possible to catch some of this colour on areas where you don't want it, and if you do that, just neaten up on those parts before you move on to the next step. With that dry brushing applied, you can see now all the texture of those feathers is standing out nicely, and so is the texture of the fur down on the tails. And what we're ready to do now is move on to the next step, which is to dry brush again, only this time using Cyberite Green, and in a very small area. We're just going to aim for the claws this time, the front claws, and so for this we only need a small amount of the paint, but like before, just use some tissue to work that paint into your brush like this, and then get rid of the excess paint on it, so you don't have very much left on there before you apply it. So the area we're looking to apply this to is, like I said, on the claws, it's these parts down here, these darker green parts just underneath the bone on the front there. So what we need to do is just start applying it here. Now it's inevitable you'll catch a little bit of these claws as you're doing this, but don't worry about that. Just neaten up with Rakarth flesh before you continue. And with that dry brushing done as well, the texture on those claws is standing out nicely. And we're now ready for the next step, which is to highlight all the remaining green flesh of the Gryph-Charger. Now, we're still going to use Cybrite Green for this, but this time the technique is going to be different. We're going to highlight it using a small airbrush. And again, you want to use your palette here, but be sure to thin your paint down a little bit more than you have been doing. So you want it to run very smoothly from the brush here. So a little bit more water than before, down to about this kind of consistency. And then just check your brush by just twisting it and dragging it along just to make sure, there we go, it's flowing really easy from the bristles. And what we need to do is start picking out all the raised details on the green flesh. Now on the claws on the front here, it's really obvious. You can see the dry brushing's picked it out. All you gotta do is just pick out those parts where the colors are strongest. So it's just around there, around where the claws emerge like that. But on the muscles, it's a little bit trickier. What you wanna do is look for the curvature of them as to where the crescent is really. So if you look at this part around here, the crescent kind of follows along just down there and then just along there. So it's where the light's catching it really. You want to pick out wrinkles as well, such as just along there. So a bit there, there, and there. And then we're gonna be following up this raised area along there. So all the time, you see, I'm just looking for the most defined features and just picking them out as neatly as possible. And with that highlight now applied to the green flesh, we're ready to move on to finishing off all the blue detail, so the feathers and the fur as well. And for this, we're going to be doing the same technique, but using blue horror this time. So first of all, we're going to dry brush it on using a small dry brush, but then we're going to add a highlight of it using a small layer brush. But first of all, for the dry brush, we need that small dry brush for it. And what we need to do is, like before, just get a little bit of that paint on the brush like that, get some tissue and use it to work the paint into the bristles, then get rid of the excess. And you really don't need very much of this paint this time. We've got to be very focused about where we're applying it. Because if we start on the feathers, this time what we're aiming to do is to paint towards the ends of them, so this kind of territory along here. So very lightly, just catching those edges down there like that, just gently building up the colour to get that nice sharp highlight. Now on the fur, what we need to do is start aiming this towards the end, so on the tail just here, I'm going to start focusing it towards this territory around here, so that it gets lighter the further around you go. And as for the feathers on the head here, what we want to do is just be very light on top of the head, just to catch the edges of those feathers around there like that, just to get that final highlight. And on the part coming down the neck here, just focus it more towards the middle around here. And then still with blue horror, this time apply it as a highlight using a small layer brush. And what we're looking to do here is to pick out all the sharpest features, which the dry brushing will have started to reveal. So we're looking at areas which are just along here, just to pick out the expression on the Gryph-Charger. As for the feathers though, don't worry about picking out all these ones like this, just look for the more prominent ones. For example, on the forelimbs, we've got these ones here. I'm just going to pick out the ends of them like this. And with that highlight applied, all the blue feathers and fur are complete, and we're ready to move on to finishing off the next detail on the Gryph-Charger, which is going to be the beak. Now for this, we're going to return to Avalan Sunset first of all, before finishing off with a highlight of a shabty bone. So first of all, we need Avalan Sunset, and I'm going straight to the small airbrush right from the start here, because we want lots of control here. You don't really need to apply that much to this. So again, as always, use your palette to get that paint ready, making sure the brush isn't overloaded. And what we're looking to do is to apply this to the beak, but being careful to keep that shade still in the recesses from the Reichland flesh shade we applied earlier. We want to keep the warmth of that colour. So as we apply this, what we're looking to do is to look for those areas such as just underneath the mouth there, and then just apply this to the flatter area just a distance away there like that. Just being really neat, as careful as we can as we go around all the blue just there. And then use a shabty bone applied once again with a small airbrush to pick out all the sharpest edges of the beak. And with that, the beak is complete, and we're now ready for some very small details on the Gryph-Charger, because now we need to paint in its eyes. Now to do this, we need two colours. First of all, we need Flashkit's yellow to paint the eye, but then we're going to need a Baden black to paint the pupils. First of all though, with Flashkit's yellow, I definitely recommend using a small layer brush here, and really you don't need very much of this, but what we're looking to do here is to use this to really brighten up the eye before we paint in the pupil. So just get a small amount in your palette, again thin it down as always, and just be really careful to make sure your brush isn't overloaded. And then what you need to do is hold the model as steady as possible, and what I tend to do is hold it so the eye is going sideways and my brush can just paint across it in this kind of motion, you see, because this way you can be really steady and all you've got to do is just paint a couple of lines in the middle like this just to fill in the centre of the eye, leaving it darker all the way around the outside. Then you're ready to paint in the pupils using a Baden black, and for this, as before, just hold the model as steady as you can, and all you need to do is just paint a small amount of this colour towards the front of each eye. And there we are, the eyes are complete, and you can see this adds loads of character to the Gryph-Charger. And in fact, the Gryph-Charger is very nearly finished. The next thing we need to paint on it is all those darker bone areas, the parts earlier that we base coated using dried bark. For this, first of all, we'll need Gorthor Brown, and then we're going to add a very fine highlight of a shabty bone. But first of all, we need Gorthor Brown, and there's quite a few areas to apply this to. So what we need to do first of all is get it ready using the small layer brush as always, making sure the paint's flowing very smoothly. And once you've done so, you're ready to start picking these features out. Now, the first areas to do are on the forelimbs, and that's these ridges that we've got running along here. For this, it's very easy. All you've got to do is just run along those sharper edges like that, just picking them out as neatly as you can. Now for the hooves on the back, what we need to do is just emphasize the texture of them. So for this, you can see there's kind of vertical ridges running in them. What we're going to do is just follow along those by just painting some vertical lines like this, just to help really bring out the texture of them like that. Now we also need to highlight the gloves at this point, and for this, like with those ridges on the forelimbs, what you want to do is just look for those sharper edges. You can see they're very nicely defined, and all you do is just follow along them like that as neatly as possible. Now the last area to highlight with this colour is the horns, and for these, it's a bit like the hooves. What we need to do is create the texture on them by painting lines or going all the way down the length of the horn. So what you need to do is, again, brace the model as steady as you can and just start painting some lines going from the very tip, following all the way down, and just fading that line out around about there. Just bring it to a point so it just disappears like that. Now the horns is the trickiest part of this, but just take your time, be as neat as you can. If you do make any mistakes, just neaten back up with dryad bark. That done, we can now add a finer highlight of a shabty bone. Now this time you don't need to worry about the gloves, but we need to add a small amount of this onto the other areas. So first of all, these ridges here, what we're going to do is just add a very fine highlight just towards the very tips. Not very much, just a small amount just to give a bit of sharpness to that detail. Now for the hooves, once again, you don't need very much, but just small amounts, just focusing towards the tops of them here. So just little bits along those lines that you painted previously like that. As for the horns, what we want to do is the same technique, following along those lines you painted previously, but going from the tips of the horns to around about halfway back this time. And with those features completed, we're now ready to begin highlighting all of that gold armour. Now for this, the colour we need is Liberator Gold, and again I'm going to use the small airbrush to apply it. And as before, we want to pick out all those sharper edges and features just to really add a nice highlight to them, just to finish them off. So as always, use your water to get the paint thinned down so it's flowing really smoothly, and it's just a matter of looking for all those edges. Now, they're nice and clear on this, so if you look at this arm we've got on the front of the Gryph-Charger, we're looking at just running the brush along edges, just along here and just around there. So just a matter of taking your time, going all the way around all this gold detail on the miniature. And with that highlight applied to the gold, we're ready to move on to highlighting the next colour. And this is going to be all the blue detail. Now for this, the colour we need is Outdoor Guard Blue. And once again, we're going to use the small airbrush to apply it. And as before, you just want to pick out all those sharper corners, edges and details. And this time, because we're doing this on fabric mostly, we want to look for the creases on it as well. So once your paint is ready, the kind of thing we're looking for, if we take a look at this blue fabric we've got just along here, what I'm looking to do is to look for any sharper creases that are standing out more and just paint a bit of this colour running along them like that. And like that. And then of course we want to go around the edges as well, getting that sharper detail, so be sure to go all the way around the edges of the blue areas too. Now that the blue detail is completed, we're ready to start highlighting the next colour. This is going to be all the red detail, and for this we need Wild Rider Red. Once again, small airbrush, and this time for the red we're looking to highlight all of it, so not just the saddle cloth, but every red detail that we've done so far. And a lot of these are quite small, so once you're ready, you just need to be really careful picking those out. For the gems, that means just picking the central ridge and the bit that crosses over towards the bottom. So just very lightly, just draw your brush just to catch that sharp line down the very centre. There like that. Now for the saddle cloth, you'll just want to pick out the peaks of these folds in the fabric, so such as just this area just there like that, and just along there. And as for the helmet crest, for this what you want to do is pick out the raised strands. So when you're applying this colour here, if you just use the side of your brush, you'll get a much sharper line as you just follow along the raised areas like this. And there we are, with the red detail highlighted, we've just got a few more colours left to highlight to finish off the model. And these all follow the same technique as what we've been doing, so we're going to run through them quickly for you now. First of all, we need Mechanicus Standard Grey to highlight all the black detail, and this is going to be followed by White Scar for all the inside of the robes, and also all the lightning bolt sigils. After that, we're going to need Pink Horror for the weapon grips, and this is going to be followed by Stormhost Silver for all the silver details. Finally, we need Pallid Witch Flesh, and this is going to be for all the detail we previously painted using Rakarth Flesh, so the tabard, the claws, all that sort of thing. But first of all, we're going to be starting out with Mechanicus Standard Grey, again with a small layer brush, and this is just going to be a case of picking out all those black details and just painting along all the edges with this colour. So, as before, use the palette to get that paint ready, making sure it's just a bit thinner than normal, and once you've done so, it's just a matter of looking for those black details and painting lines of this colour along the sharper edges. So if we take a look at this strap we've got here, what I'm going to do is just very carefully paint a line just running along the edge there like that. You just repeat this technique with all of the black details. Next, we're ready to highlight all the white features using White Scar. So this will be things like the lightning bolt sigils that we've got here, following along the edges of them just like this as neatly as possible. And on the robes, we just want to pick out the tops of the creases, so just along here. Next up, we need Pink Horror, and this is for the weapon grips. Now with this, again, use your small airbrush, but just make sure you don't have much paint in your brush, and just very lightly run it across the texture of the grips like this, just to pick out the raised details. Then we need Stormhost Silver to highlight all the silver details. So once again, following all the edges using your small layer brush, and just really take your time on the scale mill along here, just going along those sharper edges like this. Now during this step, if you want to, you can use a silver to add a further highlight to the gold. This is entirely optional, but if you decide to do it, all you need to do is paint a very small amount just in the very sharpest areas of the gold, such as just the top of this knee pad, just there. And finally, highlight the parchment and the tabard using Pallid Witch Flesh. Now, once you've done this, all you've got to do is base your miniature, and as always, we recommend you base it in the same way as the rest of your army. And with the base fully painted, this Lord-Arcanum on Gryph-Charger is complete, ready to summon forth the power of Azir and smite Sigmar's foes. So when you're painting this miniature, there's a couple of things to remember, and the first of these is that when you're applying shade to the miniature, just be careful of how much you apply at once, because you'll often not want to paint this all over the miniature. For example, with the gloss rattle and flesh shade, you only want to catch this on his armour, you don't want to get it onto the Gryph-Charger's flesh. Later, if you decide to highlight the miniature when you're dry brushing the feathers, it can be tricky to get the dry brushing exactly where you want it and not catch other details, so just take your time with this and be as neat as you can, and if you do make any mistakes, just neaten up afterwards. Finally, if you decide to do the edge highlights, again with these, just be as neat as you can, because the sharper these highlights are, the better your miniature is going to look. So there you go. Now, we really hope you guys have enjoyed this video and learned something from it. And remember, you can use the techniques and methods we've shown you to paint just about any miniature in the Stormcast Eternal Sacrosanct Chamber. So have fun, and we'll see you all again soon.